last game of the day is Dota 2. Keep watching Ucypher, Naya Sport, Naya Superstars.
Welcome back to Ucypher. Today we're going to watch Crusaders take on the Akramaks.
Is the Radiant ban? The Dire get a ban. Radiant's turn to ban.
Ladies and gentlemen, a big warm welcome Dire's back to Ucypher Season 1. It's Crusaders taking on Akramaks in today's Dota 2 matchup. I'm CloudX, aur mere saath hai Vivek. Aaj, what's happening, Vivek?
I mean, Akramaks come into this game with 6 points. They recently managed to edge out Crusaders in a game of Counter-Strike. They've started their day on a good note. Let's see if they can carry forward the momentum into Dota 2. Now, both teams have a mix of old and new blood. Darshan seems to be taking the draft for Crusaders. Invincible is their star mid laner. I believe he's young. A lot to prove at this early stage in his Dota 2 career. Then you got RemStaR, the good old hands to guide him through the tough times. RemStaR will be playing the same thing. And yeah, Invincible in the mid lane. On the side of Akramaks, Grape Soda is their coach, one of your former teammates. I mean, everybody here is a former teammate of yours. So yeah, you got Grape Soda coaching them, subbing them in. I can see him guiding them through the draft. You've also got their in-house cheerleader, Saga Vyas, who's playing cricket for them.
Yeah, I mean, he's definitely been like the guiding force for them. Unfortunately, it looks like I'm having a bit of an issue with my Dota 2 here.
Absolutely.
I'm gonna jump back into the game real quickly. But like you were saying, you know, Crusaders, they've got that mix of old and new blood, whereas it is all new blood on the side of Akramaks. The one old school player that they had, Grape Soda, he's no longer a part of the roster, or rather he's saying he's at the substitute for this particular matchup. I'm not sure if this is going to come back to hurt them later on, but if it is, you know, Akramaks will be banging themselves in the head for not having him play in this for this game.
Yeah, Grape Soda has been one of the more reliable five positions in the history of Indian Dota, and it's good to have somebody who's safe, consistent, stable and experienced in your lineup. Back to the draft, one of the most unique things I've ever seen in Indian Dota altogether is A, an Earth Spirit ban, and B, an Earth Spirit pick. Crusaders have banned out the Earth Spirit, and yesterday we saw Earth Spirit getting picked up. I mean, I hope that whoever's watching picks up someone's a couple of cues from these teams and does consider the Earth Spirit as a four position every now and then in Indian Dota. As for the picks so far, you got Lich and Sand King coming out from Crusaders. I like the picks. You got Lich, one of the better five positions in this patch. You also got Sand King, who's a decent roamer. Just needs to keep tabs on his experience and his level so that he can get points in that Barrow Strike. And he's working with that extra range as well once he gets points into the Barrow Strike. Akramaks, on the other hand, they've gone for two heroes that won EG the International. You got the Earthshaker as well as the Ancient Apparition. I'm curious to see if they're looking for a Void. There is space for it. I mean, Earthshaker does get a fair amount of play in the 4 position. And the Void could go to the off lane or just be played in the safe lane. And then Akramaks has such devastating team fight. Next set of bans from Crusaders, I mean, they're one step ahead of me. They've banned out the Void themselves. They've also banned out the Juggernaut. While Akramaks, they've taken away the Bloodseeker as well as the Monkey King. Bloodseeker, I don't know. He's good. People are picking him a lot. There is synergy with certain heroes like, say, the Venomancer or a Bristleback, a Zeus and a Bloodseeker, because they can get Bloodseeker those stacks and thirst and give them that extra movement speed and damage. But it seems that Akramaks just don't want to go up against any of that. You're also seeing a Monkey King ban coming up from Akramaks. I understand why, because Akramaks, or rather the Monkey King, is one of the safe laners who just doesn't need too much help. I mean, especially when he's up against a melee offlaner, all he has to do is walk up to him and pound away on him with the staff, get those stacks of Jingu Mastery, and with that extra range and those stacks of Jingu Mastery, he really, really hurts the enemy offlaner. Next pick from Akramaks, they're going to go for the Underlord, one of A35's most preferred heroes, and even Signify do like to run him a fair bit. We're seeing an Underlord getting picked up. He's probably going to go to the offlane. The Pit of Malice is good setup for an Ice Blast, or maybe even just a Fissure, which could be further set up for an Ice Blast. For those of you wondering where CloudX is, he's having machine problems, and I'm pretty much giving a monologue, but yeah.
Sorry, man. I'm going to look into your PC and see what I can make of this draft, because my Dota seems to be constantly crashing. it's running for now. Hopefully it stays online for the better part of this game. But yeah, like you said, the Underlord has come out. It's a really tanky offlaner that Akramaks have chosen to pick up for themselves. They've got themselves that Earthshaker alongside the Ancient Apparition as well. So it's a lot of team fight coming out on the side of Akramaks. Crusaders, unke paas kaafi saari team fight bhi hai. They have that Lich for themselves. Sand King bhi hai unke mix mein. Lots of control, lots of AoE magic damage, lots of disables coming out from them as well. But I don't know if this is enough to deal with an Underlord in the off lane.
Exactly.
Lich is good at the middle lane to deny EXP. He's not so good versus the Underlord, who's tanky as all high health.
Absolutely, Underlord jo hero hai, matlab usko safe lane. What?
Okay.
Is this an offlane Enchantress or an offlane Sand King?
Dal mein kuch kala hai, Vivek. Something is up their sleeves here for Crusaders. They've chosen to pick up an Enchantress, which I assume will be the four position roaming hero. Now, who's the micro god on the side of Crusaders?
Seconds.
Who's the one that can control multiple units and still keep us cool while dictating the pace
Five
of this game?
5 seconds remaining.
It's going to be a Sand King on the offlane. I think that's fairly well established. We should see Lich going as the 5-position support, and then Enchantress is going to have a lot of pressure upon her to make this rotation towards mid, but look at what Akramaks respond with. Smart stuff. Sword Samajkar, they're going to pick up a Weaver for themselves as their core. A mobile hero, something that can abuse the fact that Enchantress relies on slows to land her follow-up stuns.
Absolutely. Killing the Weaver is going to be hard. And he's also got the Swarm, which is going to help bring down the Enchantress, take away that armor and make all those few hits versus Untouchable just count for that much more. Crusaders, next pick for them, they're probably going to reveal one of their big cores here. Bunch of options have been removed. If you want to go all out push, you could look at something like the Draw Ranger, but we haven't seen that in ages. I'm not a fan of the Draw here actually, because it's so easy for someone like a Weaver to just run through battle and jump right on top of you. But instead, Crusaders, they're going to pick up the Ember Spirit.
Yeah, I like this. I can get behind the Ember Spirit. The Searing Chains does apply the Roots. Roots are a good way to hold on that Weaver. All of this contingent upon the fact that someone on Crusaders always has detection. Weaver, one of the best ways to shut him down is to reveal him with the dust and then grab him with the Searing Chains, hold him in position with the Burrow Strike and then finish the job with some sort of burst damage. They're lacking the burst in the burst damage department right now on the side of Crusaders, but you know, if the Ember Spirit goes for the magic damage build with the Veil and the Triple Remnant, that could be more than enough to seal the deal. Akramaks, meanwhile, I like their lineup so far. I think they've got mobility, they've got lockdowns, they've got tankiness. What they're missing right now is a high-impact, tempo-controlling middle laner, something that can deal with that Ember Spirit, and I would like to say that the Queen of Pain is a good fit.
I was going to say the exact same thing. Just looking if there's anything else they can consider. What's missing in the lineup? I mean, the Quap is a very good fit here, but I mean, something that might help them siege when we do bad either.
I feel like the Weaver is decent at sieging. Especially if you go for the Dragonlance, you have the range to stay a little further away from that tower while doing a fair bit of damage. Especially if he chooses to pick up the BKB this game. I'm not certain that a Lincoln holds a lot of value for the Weaver this game. There's the only real single target spell he's going to dodge is the Burrow Strike, which you'd rather not have to deal with after the Searing Chains coming through. The Lincolns can also be triggered by the Enchantress from a long range enchant, so I'm not sure if the Lincolns is the best choice. A straight up Dragonlance into BKB, Dragonlance into Desert into BKB perhaps would be the better choice for the Weaver. Even a Manta style wouldn't be too bad.
You can Manta out of the Searing Chains if I'm not mistaken. So the Manta style is definitely worth considering. Last pick on the board, it's RemStaR's hero. RemStaR taking his time, chewing through the reserve time. It is their last pick after all.
Unless we've read this wrong and they send the Ember Spirit to the safe lane, in which case, they're still looking for a middle laner. Akramaks, meanwhile, I think it's fairly safe to say that they're lacking a middle laner. Mid hero, what are the options?
I mean, I was thinking of the TA. You mentioned the Queen of Pain. I like the Queen of Pain. I don't mind the TA as well.
Oh. Okay.
This got the Spectre coming out. This tournament has been full of surprises. An Earth Spirit pick, an Earth Spirit ban, implying that Crusaders have done their research, and a Spectre comes out of the middle of nowhere.
Are you sold by this Spectre pick?
I'm not.
I'm not agreeing with that.
Of looking at it is that it is late game insurance. There are problems though. Crusaders sort of suck at taking down buildings. I mean, the Enchantress can if she gets units, and somewhat, it's not the best.
So if I were to analyze this, I'd say it's a 4 protect 1 strategy coming out from Crusaders. You're going to have Ember Spirit, Enchantress, Sand King and Lich grouping up early, hoping that the Spectre can pull out an early Radiance. Problem is, without the lockdown on the Weaver, Spectre's not going to be able to do enough damage upon him, and I still don't see Crusaders having a response for that Weaver pickup. And oh, ouch. Okay, you want to farm? We'll farm right back at you, says Akramaks. They're going to pick up an Alchemist for Pico, a mid lane Alchemist. Aghanim's upgrades available on 3 of those heroes. I like this pickup coming out from Akramaks. It's greedy, no doubt, but Crusaders doesn't really have too much to shut him down. I mean, the Enchantress, a lot of rotations from the Enchantress are going to be required on the mid lane early on, but if she fails to do that, Kiko's going to run away with this game.
So, Darshan is their 4 position, right?
So it would seem. Actually, Darshan's probably going to be playing the off lane this game.
I mean, Darshan is that drafter. I spoke to the players before the game did begin, and they said that we all chip in the draft. But I do know that their 4 position calls the shots early on in the game. I don't know. What do you think? Like, Enchantress has been running the offlane internationally a fair bit.
Enchantress is running versus an Earthshaker.
It is a hard offlane. Anyway, it is a very hard offlane.
It's hard
for the Sand King as well.
You bet it is. I mean, and who's to say that neither of them are just going to... Both of them aren't just going to go into the jungle right from the get-go, right? You get one side of the jungle for the Sand King with the Bounty Rune, you get the other side of the jungle for Barkemono to go ganking. I'd like to see this Enchantress on the offensive. I don't want to see an offlane Enchantress, primarily because there's an Alchemist on the other side and you have to shut him down in the first 10 minutes of the game.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, in a sense, RemStaR and his team definitely need to hold on. If Spectre doesn't get off to a good start, and all of that is contingent to the Enchantress as well as the 4 position or whoever it is, contingent to the Enchantress and the Sand King having a good early game.
Yeah.
If they don't get off to a good start, if RemStaR doesn't get space, that Spectre pick means absolutely nothing. They really have to enable RemStaR in this game.
Yeah, absolutely. They have to enable RemStaR, but even after enabling RemStaR, I'm worried that they may not have the lockdown to help him out. Invincible,
okay.
We've known him to be that high impact, early game, aggressive player. He's a kid, let's not sugarcoat it. He's like 16 or 17 years old. He loves playing Dota. He loves playing aggressive Dota, and his motto hasn't been to kill creeps, it's been to kill opponents and to outskill his opponents. Mm-hmm. It's very reminiscent of another legendary player that we know on the Indian esports circuit. I'd like to see him live up to that name. Let's see if he can pull off a hell of a performance here in his debut matchup on the main stage.
Absolutely.
A little more backstory about these players. Now, on the side of Crusaders, RemStaR is considered as the old man of Indian Dota. He's been around for donkey's years now, playing since the early versions of Warcraft Dota as well. He's transitioned into Dota 2. He did take a bit of a breather somewhere along the lines, but now he's back with a bang, and he's back on the main stage of Ucypher. He is going to be the guiding force behind their team. Not only is the captain for the Dota 2 team, he's also the captain for their entire squad.
Yeah, can RemStaR, who resurfaces from the dead here for all purposes in the Indian Dota scene, guide his team to their first victory in the Ucypher League? Mm-hmm. I mean, a couple of old legends have so far not performed as well as we would have expected of them. They are looking a bit shaky, just getting used to the game after really long. And let's see how RemStaR and the boys do this time around. Very quickly, in terms of draft, are you leaning more towards the Dire this game?
I want to say that the Dire, if I was a betting man, or let me put it in a better way, if I had any money to bet, I would bet on the Dire. I think they are the ones with the stronger lineup. They have that Alchemist for late game insurance. They have the Weaver with the mobility. And they've got a fantastic set of supports with the Ancient Apparition and the Earthshaker. Another interesting thing that we didn't point out, Ancient Apparition is great versus the Enchantress, essentially nullifying her nature's attendance if you tag her with the Ice Blast. So it's a great way to shut down that healing. It's a great way to ensure that the fight goes in your favor. And on top of all of that, their cores are so tanky.
Absolutely.
Mobile. It's going to be so difficult to kill an Alchemist, an Underlord, and a Weaver all over the course of one team fight.
Yeah.
When your only real AoE is a Sand King and a Lich, who can honestly be evaded quite easily.
Yeah, I mean, the Ancient Apparition pickup is really smart. If I'm not mistaken, yeah, they did ban up the Monkey King themselves, so he's one of the few cores that does well versus the Alchemist in lane. They had this planned all along. They wanted to pick up the AA, ban out the Monkey King, who does well in the mid lane versus the Alk, and pretty much set up the game for the Alchemist. They've also got a good offlaner who's rather self-sufficient. He's also a pesk you have to deal with in the laning phase. I mean, the Sand King and the Enchantress have their work cut out for them. If anything, the pressure is on RemStaR and the boys to try and get as many kills early on, just try and get Spectre involved at the right time.
Uh-huh.
And give the Spectre as much space as possible. It's 4 Protect 1, like you said during
indeed,
the draft.
Indeed. So, well, while we've got this extended pause coming on, let's throw a little more backstory about these players. Fun fact about Darshan, aka the Sand King, is, well, his nickname reads Darshan, but his real name is Darshan. He's absolutely dedicated to the game of Dota, so much to the point where he actually has a tattoo of the Dota logo on himself.
Okay.
So he is all in, he's completely invested in this, and you know, I mean, it's rare to see a player that loves the game so much that they actually imprint it onto their own body. I like the guy. I'd like to see what he's got up his sleeves inside the game as well.
Yeah. Has he been around since Warcraft Dota?
I'm not certain I saw his name back then.
Okay, he's one of the newer players. Well, do you know which team he played on? I remember seeing this name, I just can't recollect. Blue Frog though is still active.
Yeah.
He's playing with Artista in the same team. I sort of forget their name. So many teams, so many players, so much Dota.
And that's a good thing though.
That is a good thing.
It's an ecosystem that's booming this year.
It is.
There's also a fun fact here that SSK is the only player on this entire circuit of Ucypher that's traveled from across the Maharashtra borders to come in and play some Dota here on the main stage.
Yeah.
He's come all the way down from south. If I'm not mistaken, he's from
Orempo.
Chennai.
Oh yeah, he's from... Yes, I mean, I
think he's from Chennai.
I think he's from
Either way, he's come from down south. He's come into Mumbai to stay and play this tournament. Again, another player that is supremely dedicated to the game of Dota and supremely dedicated to build his budding esports career.
Absolutely. Only those... only the best get here. And we certainly do have them amongst us in the main stage. Long pause coming out. A couple of settings just being sorted out. The good lucks, the GL, the HF, all being thrown in all chat, and we're good to go. Let's start off with the introductions. I'm going to take on Crusaders. Invincible going to be playing the Ember Spirit. Spectre handled by RemStaR. Darshan going to be playing the Sand King. Seems like he's going to be heading to the offlane. Bakemono playing the Enchantress, and that leaves us with SSK Ascension playing the Lich.
On the other side is Akramaks with Weaver in the hands of Aggressive. It's going to be Underlord played by Dream. Ancient Apparition is going to be handled by Makusu. Earthshaker played by Blue Frog, ROFL, and that puts Alchemist in the hands of Kiko.
They aren't giving us a moment. Makusu, he's been caught on the wrong half of the river and he's been pushed back, slowed down with that spectral dagger, and Invincible scores first blood. You spoke about how Hussein likes to get aggressive early on. Beautiful stuff coming out from the Crusaders here. And this is a good start. Not sure what the Ancient Apparition was doing there. I have no idea. He didn't drop a ward. Wait, he dropped a sentry.
I mean, he dropped a very casual sentry.
No, wait, that's
a radiant sentry, actually, yeah.
So he didn't drop a ward. And now look at this, Crusaders are smoked up and they're on the hunt. They're going to contest the rune. The Ancient Apparition is yet to join his teammates. And even then, I'm not sure if he offers too much.
Oh, they know that the Alchemist loves that early bounty rune with the Grievous Greed bonus kicking in. They want to get this kill on him. And they know he's going to be standing there like a sitting duck. Here we go. Bakemono leading the charge. They have the Enchanted again. Makusu. Not like this. He's been tagged with the Spectral Dagger as well as the Enchant Slow. They don't have the range for the Burst Strike just yet, but Darshan is not giving up just yet. Looks like they finally will give up, considering that they went under the tier 1 tower. No Bounty Rune for the Alchemist, no Stun Lock onto RemStaR. They're gonna back away now, and Crusaders, they're happy with the way this game has started.
That was such beautiful Dota, having a smoke early on, getting that kill because of the enemy's silliness, and then trying to capitalize even further. The denied Alchemist the Bounty Rune. So look at that, he's low on consumables, and Invincible is just trying to abuse this as much as possible. Makusu has to pretty much sit in the mid lane, sure he's got the cold feet, but yeah, he needs to really help Kiko early on. The good news is Invincible doesn't have Flame Guard for a bit. So the Alchemist is going to farm a little bit. But this immediately means that the other lanes are left a little vulnerable with the absence of the Ancient Apparition.
Yeah, but that's been counterbalanced with the presence of the Lich on the middle lane, though. He's actually started with the Frost Blast. No sacrifice available because he wanted that kill on that Ancient Apparition. Mm-hmm. I think Kiko will be quite happy with this. He's not going to lose out on too much EXP. The range creep is still available and alive. And the creep wave is coming under his tower. Unfortunately, he doesn't have the Quelling Blade to help him last hit under that tower right now.
Mm-hmm. Top lane. इस लेन पे भी मुझे लगता है कि Crusaders को काफी favourable matchup मिला है. If the Sand King just hits level 2 and he's got points in caustic, he can actually bully Dream on the Underlord a fair bit. I foresee that this is a matchup that could go either way. I'm really not too sure why they decided to give Underlord the matchup. Maybe the point is to contest the Spectre early on. But so far, RemStaR is doing just okay. He's nearly keeping up in terms of CS with the Weaver. So,
I mean, yeah. Theoretically, मुझे लग रहा है कि Weaver को कोई threat है ही नहीं ये bottom lane में, because they've got no stuns, all they've got are slows. And
theoretically, मुझे लग रहा है कि top lane पे Dream मरने वाला है. I mean, they've got the clap, you got the power strike as well. Dream is dropping low, a couple of hits, the firestorm, the caustic slowing down Dream. He's trying to make a run for it. He's heading further south, and now he's been sent back to his own base. Beautiful stuff coming out from Crusaders here. Good rotation.
Very nicely done by Bakemono. We talked about how the Enchantress needs to be active. That's exactly what she's doing. And she's already got the boots online, so a middle lane gank might be on the cards for her as well. Kiko, he's playing it safe. You can see him not going past the river too often, and only when he has the acid spray to drop down is when he walks forward. Mm-hmm. This is not a very good lane for the Ember Spirit, to be honest, but he's having a fantastic time in terms of CS. Elsewhere on the bottom lane, looks like SSK was in a bit of trouble. He's going in the wrong direction, man. That's not your base. That's the dire side of the map, and you are a Radiant hero, which means you're going to die, and it's going to be in the hands of Aggressive. On that Weaver.
Yeah, it's okay. He's sort of, I don't want to say that space created, but he did waste the time for a fair bit.
Well, meanwhile, Invincible, we talked about how he's got 20 CS on the board, but you can see the net worth charts. Alchemist is not too far behind. This is because of the Greaves Greed and the way it works. Again, for those of you that are new to Dota 2, Greaves Greed is one of those spells that lets you get more value for each creep that you kill.
Yeah.
So if, for example, the Ember Spirit is getting about 40 gold for each creep kill, the Alchemist is getting a lot more because this is a passive ability that's always on and requires no mana. So it's the fact of the matter is, Alchemist is one of those heroes that cannot be left to farm by himself. You have to apply pressure on him early, and especially before level 6, because once he gets that Chemical Rage online, it becomes really difficult to kill.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Alchemist, I mean, it's basically happy hours in a bar with every drink he's getting 3 free. And he's having a fun time there in the mid lane. SSTK needs to be careful. The cold feet will end up proccing, but RemStaR is just pushing away the Weaver with a couple of auto attacks. He's also put 2 points into Desolate. Bakemono though, comes in with the Enchantress. The slow is there, the neutral's far away, the rock comes flying through. Aggressive gets stunned, but the stun duration not long enough. This Aggressive trial is not working out as expected for Akramaks.
Absolutely not, because RemStaR still at 13 CS. He's going blow for blow with Weaver, and Bakemono coming in here means that he's going to come with an army of neutrals. Now there's 2 boulders that can be hurled. They're going to be thrown on Makusu's head. Look at this, man. It's one Enchantress versus the world. Blue Frog, as well as the rest of his cavalry, cannot do anything in the face of her.
Mm-hmm. Dream is not doing too bad though on the Underlord. He's playing this matchup right. He's basically dropping down the Firestorm, getting that extra damage from the deaths of the creeps with the Atrophy Aura, and immediately trading hits with the Sand King. The good news is that Darshan isn't too far behind in terms of net worth, so he's going to be getting that Blink Dagger at a reasonable timing himself. And I presume a Sand King early on just has a lot more impact in team fights with a Blink Dagger than an Underlord.
Yeah, I would.
I mean, I hope the Underlord gets his mech at a good timing. It's still going to take him a bit. Mid lane, we spoke of Invincible and how he likes to get aggressive. He's had a quiet start. He's doing well in terms of CS. The problem is the Alchemist just has a whole lot of inflated net worth and is somewhat keeping up with Invincible.
Not really, man. Invincible's at 42 CS. He's badly outskilling and outplaying this Alchemist by himself. Bakemono is being pinged out here. He's up on the high ground, firing off those Hadoukens towards the middle lane while farming up enemy neutral creeps. There's a courier flying out as well. That's a dead giveaway by where Bakemono is hanging out. And Now with those phase boots, Blue Frog has to be really careful because if Bakemono decides to turn his attention towards him, he's got two very tanky
mid lane. Hiko dropping low, caught in the chains. He's got the Flame Guard. Invincible low on mana. The Fisher will slow down Invincible. Here comes SSK. He's got the Frost Blast, but he's not got boots. Bakemono with the Shockwave coming in from the Satyr. He's trying to control Kiko. There's the Frost Blast. This kill could be huge. Bakemono, though, can't battle through that Chemical Rage and will end up going down. SSK on the run. Blue Frog, another Fisher. Not ideal. Still enough room for SSK to wiggle out. And the Lich is going to survive.
It's 2-for-2 now. Both teams going blow for blow. Crusaders still with a minor net worth lead, but that says a lot given that there's an Alchemist on the other side of the map. Kiko, he did pop his Shrine. He's back with Power Trance. He has the Chemical Rage in 10 seconds, but Invincible is just walking all over him. When your middle laner is going blow for blow in terms of net worth, when the Ember Spirit has more net worth than the Alchemist, it says a lot about how hard Invincible is actually winning this lane. Yeah. He's just popping Flame Guard after Flame Guard, constantly pushing out the wave, constantly farming efficiently in the face of this Alchemist. And with an early item advantage on this Ember Spirit, he could cause all sorts of havoc across the map.
Yep, what are we looking at in terms of items for the Ember? You think magic damage? Yeah, that's what he's queued
up.
Yep,
it has to be magic damage.
Okay.
I thought I saw a smoke. Makusu popped a solo smoke here to go on a warding expedition. He does get that one Observer Ward placed down in the middle lane, but this may not be the ideal Observer Ward, considering it's on the dire side of the map to start with, and secondly, I'm not sure how important runes are now that we've crossed the 7-minute mark and the Alchemist has just gone into the jungle.
How is Makusu so poor? 7 minutes in, he has an Observer Ward and barely enough gold to buy another.
I mean, that was his first creep kill of the entire game. Oh no, never mind. He's got 3 creep kills. My bad. It's the Lich that has no creep kills whatsoever.
Yeah, but still, SSK has more net worth. I mean, both these supports, they're taking a hit for their cores here.
Bakemono, he's slowing down a bit. He's just using the jungle to keep farming while using that tornado to zone out Blue Frog. They want to go in on the Earthshaker, but they're going to need a lot more than just a tornado and a frost blast. Yeah. RemStaR, by the way, has had all the space in the world to keep farming here on this bottom lane. They're just helping him get his early items online, protecting him like they need to protect their captain. And pretty soon he'll be looking to build his Radiance.
Yeah, from what I've seen of RemStaR, I know he likes to get aggressive early. I'm waiting for him to hit level 6. And I presume him and Dashin teaming up together could possibly bring down the Underlord. Because RemStaR's put points into Desolate. So if, oh look at this, mid lane, Invincible goes in, Remnant Chains, Kiko comes running in with the Haste Rune. Makusu, he's gonna die, he's gonna get poorer. And Invincible has a Remnant to jaunt away. Kiko running him down, the Flame Guard soaking up some of that Fisher damage, but the Fisher's blocked in away from his own shrine. Bakemono comes in with the creep just to push them away. But Invincible, he's got a kill and he's gotten away scot-free.
Yep, they do manage to get a kill and break away. Makusu goes poorer again. This is not looking good at all for the Ancient Apparition. Even if he wanted to pick up Tombs for the experience to get him to level 6 early, he doesn't have the money for them. Aggressive though, he's been tagged with the dagger. He doesn't have a time lapse and he just Shikuchi'd in. He's got another one coming online shortly and they can't keep the chase going. Perhaps a Chain Frost, if it was available on SSK, would have made a difference there. But he's quite far behind in terms of levels for now.
Yeah. Top lane. Yeah, Bakemono caught in the Pit of Malice. You got the Firestorm, the Cold Feet a little late. And the Ice Vortex is not enough to slow him down and hold him in place. Heal us.
Looking at Darshan meanwhile. He's just got his eyes focused on that Blink Dagger. He's picked up his Arcane Boots, along with that Magic Stick. And the Blink Dagger, it's not looking too far off either.
He's actually going to try and make a play elsewhere on... Oh, he's TP'd back to base. He's making a base trip.
Both sides playing it fairly passively. I'm expecting Invincible to get more active once he finishes the Veil. And it's going to come at a beautiful timing as well, because he's going to get the Veil as soon as he hits level 10, though that extra magic damage amplification is going to come out as well. So he's going to hit a massive power spike by then. He might want to wait for one more level, just for good measure, to get that Sleight of Fist online, so he can guarantee the Searing Chains.
But look at this. Smoked up. Bakemono and Darshan moving towards the mid lane. Kiko, he's got Makusu to sit behind him.
But Makusu's out of mana and has no consumables whatsoever. They're up on the high ground already, Bakemono and Darshan, and they're ready to rumble.
Yeah, I guess they're just trying to scout out any stacks if the Alchemist has any to fall back on. Darshan's got points in Burrow Strike, as well as the Epicenter. And it seems as if Kiko sensed what is going on. He fell back to the east side of the jungle, and he's just going to farm up over there. This aggressive cry lane, though, coming out from Akramaks, I'm not too sure if it's paid any dividends. I mean, the good news is that the underlord's getting farmed. That's about it.
The only real value that I see from this aggressive tri lane is that it did kind of concentrate the Enchantress's efforts towards the bottom lane, which gave the Alchemist enough space and time to farm up that armlet. And now at level 6, with an armlet online, he's not that easy to take down. But look at this Invincible, that was just way too cocky. He's gonna get beaten up by Kiko now, smacked in the face by the armlet hits. No acid spray dropped down by Kiko in the middle of that fight, and that's gonna come back to hurt him, because here comes the Sand King with the Bio Strike, securing the kill. Kiko is down, the net's worth to his hands. Invincible is running, he's got the bottle charges going along for him as well. He should make it out, and so too does the Sand King. All the while forcing rotations from Dream, who's now coming with a pair of Malice. Invincible still making a run for it. He can't turn around. Spectre comes into the play. The Hawk is using the reality. He's going for Blue Frog. Blue Frog is going to take one more hit and go down, as RemStaR's just going to walk over the trees, lifts his skirt, and smacks him in the back. Now he's come back for Dream. He doesn't want to duke it out with an Underlord there. Underlord's Atrophy Aura does kick in, while Invincible actually went back in and got down Makusu. Now he's looking at Dream himself. Has the Searing Chains in 1 second's time, but needs to back away. But the Alchemist is TPing back into the fray.
Beautiful stuff coming out from Crusaders here. RemStaR getting aggressive early on. The points in Desolate is proving to be too much for the Earthshaker. Darshin came in at the right time, got the Butter Strike off, even committed the Epicenter, which was cancelled by that Fissure. And once again, Invincible. It seems as if all these players from the side of Crusaders have got each other's backs. Aggressive, just not showing up in the mid lane.
Gonna quickly look if there's any stacks in the jungle here for the Alchemist to farm. Unfortunately, none of his supports have set up a jungle for him. I mean, he is farming a bunch of ancients here, but this is not the most efficient way to be running forward as the Alchemist.
Absolutely. Which means that, well, has he picked up his armlet yet? His Radiance is not going to be coming as early as expected. And with Bakemono making a smoke play into the enemy jungle, it seems like it's going to take a little longer. Invincible and Bakemono, they're not really sure what to do. Do we try and just pressure the mid lane? Do we go hunt the Alchemist? It seems as if the mid lane is the call. Good stuff coming up from Crusaders. Of all the teams we've seen so far, they seem to be the one that shows the most amount of promise. Let's see if they can keep this going. Underlord, though, he's moved to the bottom half of the map.
I think one of the major issues here is that the Alchemist is still being left to his own devices. Even though it's a slow and steady build-up, he is managing to get a significant amount of farm rolling for himself. That Radiance isn't going to be too far off. He's definitely going to get the Radiance before RemStaR can even think about getting it, because RemStaR chose to go for the Mask of Madness. With that early Mask of Madness, sure, he can fight hard, he can farm a little harder in the jungle, but he's not going to work too well as when the horn pops in. But look at this, Invincible, he's going to go in, Kiko starts chanting up that concoction, throws it out on Invincible, who gets himself another Searing Chains, a solo kill by the kid. Really, just styling all over that Alchemist. Meanwhile, on the top side, it looks like they're going to start with a Burrow Strike. The Ice Blast is there as well. The Chain Thrust is going to get fired off. Dream is going to take a couple of hits, and Blue Frog will go down. While Dream is next on the hit list, Bakemon is going to come in here. Dream with a bit of Malice, holding them in position. The Epicenter committed behind. Makusu is going to end up losing his life and a message. He's thinking of going in on cleanup duty with Darshan in trouble. Burrow striking out, back to the low ground, back near the tower, making an escape. But is this escape going to be successful? Because Aggressive is still giving chase. Darshan, going to TP out through the trees, will be able to survive for now, while Lich will be able to walk back under his tower and get away to safety.
I mean, just prior to this fight, you said that Kiko's still getting farmed. It's almost as if Invincible heard us and wanted to prove us wrong. He's solo killing the Alchemist. I'm not really sure what's going on with Kiko. He senses he can man fight, but a Veil along with the magic amplification talent this early on, even through that chemical rage, is still too much damage, and Kiko's simply not respecting it and getting punished for his greed. Despite all of that, it seems like he's going to be getting a Radiance.
You know that it's a bad sign when the Alchemist starts to fall behind in terms of network, and there's an Ember Spirit taking the lead.
Yeah.
Ember's not the most efficient farmer, honestly, but he's farmer heroes.
Invincible goes in for Kiko once more. Remnants in, goes with the chains. The Veil of Discord has been used. Kiko dropping low. He wants to run towards the shrine. He's going to be able to tag it. His chemical rage on cooldown. RemStaR horns in, actually. A couple chains onto the Earthshaker, and it seems as if Kiko's going to run away. Blue Frog with the Fissure, the Cold Feet. Arcane Frog. And Invincible still trying his best to contest the Alchemist as much as possible.
as long as they're pressuring him time and again, I think it still works out in their favor. Chico's struggling to get his Relic online, let alone the full Radiance. We're only at 15 minutes in, but this game already has a good 11 kills on the board. The last two games in the Ucypher League have seen some very passive play coming out from both teams for the most part. This game, everyone is just going all in for the kills.
Mm-hmm. And Invincible, he still has that arcane rune. It has worn off now. The problem is, and this is something we did mention during the draft, is that Crusaders, they struggle to take down objectives. The Enchantress hasn't attempted to push out any lanes. All tier 1 towers are still standing for Akramaks. And Crusaders, I mean, they're working with the net worth lead. It's small, it's significant, they've got the kills. But really, is that enough? It's still, they're still giving the Alchemist too much space and time. And he's getting that farm. He's getting his Radiance, he's getting it slowly. But that's all he needs to get going.
Another 100 seconds till the Haunt is back online, which means that RemStaR isn't going to be able to add much value for his teammates for the next minute or so. Dream, on the other hand, is making progress towards that mechanism. Looks like it's flying out on the courier now. This is when they get a bit of a power spike once again.
Hold on, Crusaders, they smoked up the Chain Frost thrown in. Darshan with the Epicenter on top, the neutrals catch most of the Chain Frost, but Enchantress is there, and with the Frost Balash, they're going to get that kill. Makusi on the air, being chased. Darshan tagged with the cold feed. Blue Frog goes in, Enchant Totem, one hit. They're banging down Darshan on the Sand King, and with the Echo Slap, they're going to get the kill. RemStaR comes in with the Master Madness. He wants Makusu at the very least. The Fisher, well, it's only going to buy them time, and not enough for Invincible with the Searing Chains will get that kill. They got the Alchemist,
yep.
They got the Ancient Apparition. They did, however, lose their Sand King.
It's still entirely worth it, I'd say, for Crusaders. Scoring that kill on the Alchemist, putting him on the sidelines for 15 seconds, let alone leaving RemStaR alone on the top lane to keep farming. This is working out beautifully for Crusaders right now. Don't look at the net worth graph, guys. This game, the net worth doesn't mean as much. It's the EXP graph that's going to tell you the true story. 6,000 experience going in favor of Crusaders, and they're starting to take the lead, and how. RemStaR, I wonder if he's even going to switch gears and go for the Diffusal Blade and the Mantis Tail this game instead of that Radiance pickup.
You'd rather prefer the Diffusal?
I'm not entirely sure what I prefer this game, to be very honest with you. I mean, I know at some point he's probably going to need an Abyssal Blade to deal with the Weaver, but Weaver's not getting
He's going to need an Abyssal for sure. You think fight frequently with the Diffusal, or wait and hope to go late game and have some late game insurance of some sorts with the Radiance?
I think the Radiance is still going to add a lot of value, but it looks like he's chosen to become a Yasha, so it's going to be a potential Mantis Tail coming out from RemStaR on that Spectre this game. I guess I could get behind that. I mean, it's not really a response for the Alchemist, who's going to have Evasion coming online soon, by the way. He's got 4.3k gold, so the Radiance is nearly complete for him. The Yasha, it's going to give him the mobility to go behind, kill off the Earthshaker, possibly even bring down the Ancient Apparition, but it's not going to be a response to the Underlord, the Weaver, and the Alchemist.
Right.
This is what we talked about at the start of the game.
He needs to itemize to deal with the Alchemist.
It's the three tanky slash mobile cores on the side of Akramaks that are going to prove to be problems for the side of Crusaders.
Okay, it seems as if Ember's going for the Radiance here. He's got the Relic. Underlord's picked up his mechanism as well, so he's got some sustain. And it seems as if Crusaders want to force the issue. They're just marching down mid. Darshan goes in. He's got the Bounce Strike onto the Earthshaker. And with the Frost Blast, it's going to be an easy kill. Bit of Malice onto two. But there's no real follow-up from Akramaks. They're losing their tier 1 tower. And they're not even going to contest. The Alchemist as well as the Weaver. Well, it seems that they want to farm.
Yeah, they just opted to sacrifice that tower. It was unfortunate the Earthshaker got caught out behind. RemStaR, you cannot get into a farming attrition game versus that Alchemist. You know that the Alchemist is going to outfarm you. He's already 4,000 net worth ahead of the Spectre this game, and his Radiance is nearly complete. This is what Kiko was waiting for. He's got an armlet, he's almost got the Radiance, and now his farming potential goes through the roof, let alone his ability to fight back.
Top lane though, Crusaders is just going to try and push as much as possible. Maybe force Akramaks to fight before they can get those huge items that they're looking for. The Alchemist already has his Radiance. The Earthshaker, he's far away from his Blink. And it seems as if Crusaders want to abuse the lack of early teamfight, and they're just going to keep pushing.
Tier 1 tower, they've gone and taken that tier 1 on top, and no one came to contest it. aggressive on that Weaver. Yes. Still making progress towards the Dragonlance. A 20-minute Weaver without a Dragonlance. This is, I mean, forget about shameful. This is super worrisome for aggressive.
It is. It is. It's disappointing because the Weaver is not one of those heroes that intends to farm and try and delay this game as much as possible. You want to get early fighting items and participate and have impact in those fights with immobility. This time though, Invincible with the Flame Guard, he's on the hunt. The Fisher's there, holding back Invincible. Not to commit with those Remnants. And I think Hirwale wapis ghar pe aage, but it seems as if Crusaders didn't get the memo. They want to keep pushing.
RemStaR, meanwhile, he's trying to snip push bottom. Dream goes in there to match what RemStaR's doing here.
Yeah.
This is the opportunity for Crusaders. Now, they know that the Underlord has TP'd out towards the bottom lane, and they know that if they're fighting with a number of bodies, they'll try and take this tower. If at all Akramaks come to contest, Spectre can always use the Haunt and then Reality in to join the fight. Ice Plus is going to come in. It actually tags three heroes, Dire's so this might be a bit of a deterrent, but no one's coming in to offer any more support. This will be a free tier 2 tower.
They're doing it slowly and patiently. Dire's and it seems as if Akramaks just want to fight and hold on. RemStaR just pushing aggressive from the right lane, from mid lane. And the top lane tower does fall. No contest coming up from Akramaks. They're just giving up objectives. And the plan seems to be to just farm as long as possible. The problem is, there's going to be a point, I think, when you play this game where you decide to just farm, the ideal time to take a fight before holding onto high ground is when you still have a tier 2 tower standing. If you do not take a fight until you lose, hold on, it seems to be that they want to fight. They go in with the Unstable Concoction, it's caught onto Invincible, not sure if he has a Remnant, the root is there from the Pit of Malice, and they're going to get that unstoppable streak. Hiko, hunting for more.
He did have a Remnant, but he has no defensive items to break away from the Pit of Malice roots, let alone the follow-up stuns coming out from Kiko and that Earthshaker. They played him like a fiddle, got that kill, Radiant's sent 1,000 gold going in favor of Kiko, and then gave him a tower on top of it. These are the kind of mistakes Radiant's that they cannot afford to make on the side of Crusaders. Ground. You cannot disrespect the potential of an Alchemist and a Weaver in the ultra late game phase. And this is where I think that Radiance is going to come back to hurt this Ember Spirit. He might have needed some sort of defensive items, be it a Blink Dagger, be it a Yule Scepter. Mm-hmm. He's got none of them whatsoever.
You think Yules or Manta?
I actually think the Yule Scepter would have made sense for
Okay. 12-4 is the score, 22 minutes in. Crusaders not sure if they really want to go up into the late game versus an Alchemist, who's now sort of found some sense of rhythm with his farming and is pretty much farming without any contest coming up from Crusaders. Aggressive on the Weaver. I mean, his performance has been rather lackluster. He spent most of his time hitting creeps and even then doesn't have too much to show for it.
You can already see the graphs starting to turn. Both the net worth as well as the EXP graphs are now starting to tilt downwards in favor of the Dire side. Akramaks are fighting back and they're fighting back hard. We also did talk about how Akramaks, or rather how Crusaders are going to be on a bit of a clock, especially because this is one of those early to mid-game fighting specters that they're playing with that Manta Style and Mask of Madness. They need to fight now. They need to find successful team fights now, because if they wait too long, that Blink is going to come out on Blue Frog as well.
Absolutely. The plan is to push bot. The problem was Invincible ended up dying last time around. This time they're in a better position. Darshan's hanging around in the trees. The Ice Blast already came flying through. RemStaR's ready to haunt into the fight. It's time to go for Crusaders. They're going to try and apply as much pressure as possible early on in the bottom lane. Akramaks, though, it seems as if they want to defend. It's Dream with a pipe, it's Dream with a mech, and it's Darshan out of position. The Cold Feet is there. The Fisher blocks him in place. The Pit of Malice with the Ice Blast. Darshan's almost done for. The Chain Thrust comes bouncing through. The Remnants are there. It's a huge amount of damage. They lost the Earthshaker. Invincible manning up. He wants the Alchemist. The Impetus will seal the deal. And Bakimoto comes in. Another Impetus. Aggressive. Will manage to survive thanks to that Tsukuchi. RemStaR comes in, look at the damage. Mask of Madness, Flight of Fish. They get the kill on the Underlord. They're looking for Mukasu, who also goes up falling.
It's a 1-for-4 trade. RemStaR coming into that fight, making sure that they get the most of it. They actually end up getting the kill on the Enchantress as well. This is just ended up trying to kill burn damage on the sidelines there. But either way, it's a massive teamfight victory coming out for Crusaders. They even get a tier 1 tower on the back of it. And most importantly, they got the kill on that high value target, the Alchemist. With Alchemist hitting the deck, with a tier 1 tower going down there, it's opened up a lot more space on the map for Crusaders to start ganking and pushing once again.
comes for the dead.
Darshan. He's got the blink dagger on that Sand King for a while now. He's almost finished up his 4 stuff as well. Mm-hmm. There's also a double damage rune up for grabs. Perhaps just an invitation to go into the rush mid. Especially with the Enchantress and the Untouchable able to tank up that Roshan.
Yeah, they can sort of Roshan if the Enchantress soaks up the damage with the Ice Armor. And it seems that is the plan coming up from them. SSK dropping a couple of wards, getting vision around the Rosh Pit, pretty much securing Roshan for Crusaders. Ice Blast comes flying through. It's almost as if Akramaks know what is up. Bakemono walks into the Rosh Pit only after the Ice Blast comes sailing through. Ice Armor, Bakemono. Should be an easy Roshan for them. Slow but painful. The question is, do Akramaks want to contest?
Looks like they don't want to contest. This is going to be a free Roshan taken up by RemStaR. So to quickly recap what happened in the last couple of minutes, you had Crusaders winning a massive team fight on the bottom lane. They took an objective in the form of a tier 1 tower, and they get another objective in the form of Roshan. With this Aegis, could this seal the deal for them as they go forward towards what should be a high ground push? SSK on that Lich.
SSK has been pretty good as a fight position. I'm pretty impressed. And some crucial chain frost and just been a good Lich all in all. He's had a reasonable amount of impact in team fights. He's been doing his role. And if you take a look at the mini map, you've got a fair amount of radiant vision as well all across the map. Aggressive though on this Weaver. I still don't know what a Weaver does in a game where all Weaver's been doing is just farming away for 27 minutes. He's had little to no impact in team fights. He has very little farm to show for it. He's built mid-game utility, cheap mid-game items, but he hasn't done too much. And now he's going for the BKB. There is a lack of damage coming up from the Crusaders. The real source of damage is magic damage coming out from the Earthshaker and the Ancient Apparition. I'm not sure if that's going to be enough. Dream comes marching through. He's got the Pit of Malice. He got 4 star from Bakemono. And the Bottle Strike is there as well. They're controlling the Underlord. The Echo Slam on the back lines from Blue Frog. They're trying to bring down Darshan. And with the Fisher Reveal, RemStaR manages to get a kill. He's coming back for round 2. He wants the Underlord first. Invincible, his Aegis expended. Surrounded by Aggressive as well as Kiko. Kiko making a run for it. RemStaR pushing them behind with the illusions, and that was more than enough for the Crusaders to get 2 kills and possibly a tier 2 tower. The problem was they did lose the Aegis on the Ember Spirit. Bakemono going in for more.
Which honestly isn't that bad. I mean, you still got RemStaR staying alive through all of it. He's picked up a full diffusion blade in his stash, which he can call out to himself. They get a bunch of kills, they lose the Aegis, but they take an objective in the form of the tier 2 tower. Like you said, one of the major problems is that the Alchemist survived through all of that. And with that, he's going to have his Octarine Core ready for the next fight, making him that much harder to kill once more. It's slowly starting to look like signs of life being shown here by Akramaks. Maybe they could turn this game around. After all, high ground hasn't been breached just yet, and without an Aegis, I'm not sure if Crusaders even have the balls to do it.
Yeah, I presume Crusaders won't be looking for a head-on fight without Aegis. If they do somehow end up losing a fight, it's a lot of gold swinging back into Akramaks. And it's really not what they want to do. The Underlord, he's being dealt with in these fights. 29 minutes in, I'm yet to see Weaver's impact in any form in these team fights. I haven't really been...
Yeah, I'm not going to sugarcoat it. I'm very disappointed in the impact that this Weaver has brought to the table. He's done nothing. He's just been scurrying around like the little cockroach that he is, not really adding any value to the fights. Sure, the Dragonlance decision was alright, but we kind of expected to get something more impactful after the Dragonlance as opposed to a straight up BKB. Sure, he's staying alive. Sure, he's running around the battlefield, but nobody really cares because he's not doing any damage whatsoever.
I mean, if I'm not mistaken, and I'm going to definitely take a look at fight recap next time around, the Earthshaker did more damage in the previous engagement. He was largely responsible for bringing down Darshan. And Blue Frog is doing a lot more than his true one position. However, despite not having the Aegis, Crusaders just want to keep on going. They're marching down the bottom lane. It seems as if they want to force the issue. This is the last tier 2 tower for Akramaks, and do they really want to contest? RemStaR is all by himself in the top half of the map. A pick off on RemStaR means that Crusaders are left as 4 all by themselves on the bottom lane.
This is what they're doing wrong though. They're trying to fight 4 versus 4, thinking that, oh, the Spectre isn't there, so shayad we can take a fight. Darshan, gonna go in with the epicenter, catches them out. The Horn comes in almost immediately after. They've got the Pit of Malice thrown down, but Alchemist is refusing to die for now, but never mind that. RemStaR deletes him, hits the delete button on his head, while Greed is going down next. He's trying to Uber Lord out of there, but is he gonna get far enough away? Looks like he will, and he's gonna take aggressive along with him. No one on the side of Crusaders dies, while Akramaks loses their most high-value hero, the Alchemist.
That was beautiful for Crusaders. They got the Alchemist. It takes heavy commitment, but they're getting that kill. And look at that. Everybody from Akramaks just runs away. They get into their little taxi and run away, while Crusaders take down the tier 2 tower without any contest coming up from Akramaks. Akramaks are playing this 4v5 right now. And, well, it's not in their best defense. They still have the Echo Slam, though. So if the Crusaders do decide to go high ground, it's not going to be that easy.
In addition to the Echo Slam, you've got to remember that there's no Haunt on the side of the Radiant. They still have the Chain Cross, but they don't have the Echo Slam either. It is go time for Akramaks. The smart decision here would be to pop a smoke and try and find a takeoff on the Radiant, but they're finding nothing. Everybody's out.
3-4 staffs committed from Crusaders just to ensure that they don't get picked off in the retreat. This is some really good play coming out from them. And I'm actually curious to see this team and this exact same lineup participate in more tournaments. They're playing some phenomenal Dota. I'm actually quite impressed with the level of coordination between them. 31 minutes in, they have a 6k net worth advantage.
For those of you new to the way that Ucypher has been working, and you know, if you missed the earlier episodes about how the draft panned out and such, you should know that these players are a bunch of players that were picked up, at, not at random, but they were sort of bid for.
Yeah.
So they're not exactly teammates in the truest sense, but it really falls upon the team's captain to build that camaraderie. Absolutely. Amongst them. And I feel like Atul has done a really good job of bringing the Crusaders together and have got them on the same tangent, thinking along the same lines and having the same mindset and outlook on the way Dota should be played. It's working for them thus far. The scoreline tells the true story. It's 19-7. Alchemist is not running away with the net worth this game, and Crusaders have managed to convey the damage and are actually close to taking a win here.
RemStaR going for the heart. That's going to give him a lot of HP. And look at this, it's almost as if Akramaks heard us. They know that they need to do something. Aggressive wants to take part in the fight. They go in with the Echo Slam. There were a bunch of creeps. They're controlling him with the Fissure. The Ice Blast comes sailing through. This is going to delay the heart. This is going to take away his Mega Kill Streak. And this means that Akramaks finally have some fighting chance in this game. A huge gold swing in their favor. A lot of EXP as well.
This is what they should have been doing from the first real fight.
Absolutely.
Instead of trying to fight 4 versus 5 and banking on the Spectre to not show up in time, you go for the Spectre on the other side of the map. Kill
exactly.
Him off when he has no backup whatsoever.
Spectre was all by herself most of the time. Just group up, pop a smoke or usko maane ki koshish kar. It's that simple, really. Aggressive now has the BKB. This is not going to be an easy kill. They're actually moving further north, further east as well. Kiko needs to be careful. He thinks his jungle is safe. He's got the Octarine, and maybe without the Spectre, they don't have a chance. Now they're moving back. Aggressive, they do see him. They did have some form of detection. A sentry dropped, an immediate time lapse, and Aggressive, he's out of there.
He juked them, but has he juked them well enough? Because their pains are trapping him. Searing Chains will connect along with that Burrow Stack. He's going to pop the BKB to the Shukuchi. He has the BKB, and he's going to do the Arc to safety as well. Space created. Aggressive buys them some time and ensures that the Alchemist can go back to farming in the bottom lane.
Okay, 3 remnants committed from the Ember Spirit. A 10-second BKB committed from the Weaver.
Makemono going for the Aghanim Scepter up next. He's picked up a point booster here and he's just 2 components away from finishing it up. Underlord, meanwhile, we haven't taken a look at him for a while now, as Dreams picked up a 4 staff in addition to the Greaves and the Pipe. I'm a little worried about how they're going to kill anyone on the side of Akramaks now. They're super tanky. And unless they whack them with like a full 5-man combination, Chain Cross, Epicenter, Haunt at all, I don't think they're dying.
Dire's top tower is about
19-8.
It
is a 5,000 net worth advantage, but it's something that could swing right back into the favor of Akramaks. One team fight in their favor could pretty much mean that the match is once again a break even. Aggressive has that BKB as well. Darkness up, leading the charge. He does see Aggressive. He's actually invis. Excuse me, not smoke. The Ice Armor wearing off. Doesn't don't have a Lincoln Spear, there is a possibility for a two-man Burrow Strike, if not an Epicenter.
The problem is this team is nowhere in the vicinity. There's just a Lich around, everyone else is really far off, and they just weren't in a position to fight that. The call clearly seems to be, let's wait for RemStaR to get his heart. He's just a Reaver away, he's got two Vitality boosters. He's getting to the point of being unkillable himself, and you can never really count out the next version damage that's going to come out on the battlefield with the absurd amount of HP that he's walking around with. His illusions are tanky, he's able to push out, they're going to be hard to take down themselves. Maybe undercover, the smoke, but they're not going to be able to accomplish anything there.
Yeah. I mean, they were just trying to recreate their previous play, smoke up and move towards the Spectre, but RemStaR, experience counts for something. He just backed away, didn't get caught out of position.
And look at this, man. He's also gone for the all-out 10
people. Fingers crossed.
Chosen to get the 8 power stats, the last 5 armor, points, and the strength. And I really wouldn't be surprised if he goes for the plus power.
Yeah.
He's got like a good 16 armor, that's with the Master Madness debuffs kicking in. He's got himself 2.8k HP. Taking him down means you're hurting everyone else in the vicinity courtesy of the disruption. And the more HP he gets, it's only going to get harder and harder for them to bring him down. You can't even ignore the fact that Invincible is chucking out massive amounts of magic damage. He's got himself a Radiance, he's got himself a Radiance, we all know. And now he's going for the Octavine Core next, so those Searing Chains are going to come out time and time again. Meanwhile, Roshan's been scouted out, Bakemono's going to take an Ice Blast to the face.
Can't take the last 5 points,
get positioned
up. You have to wait and find out after a short
break. Yeah, Crusaders are about to hit a couple of key timings here. The Ocarina on the Ember Spit, like you mentioned, the Heart on RemStaR, even the Axe set from the Enchantress. Couple that up with Aegis and Cheese, and Crusaders could possibly go high ground, but after much, it seems as if they want to contest Ice Blast on cooldown. They're not working with too much vision around the North Pit. How does Blue Clock go away? Do they have a support to move in the direction even?
They're not even thinking of contesting this. I think they're just going to give up an Aegis. And if... Oh man, that's actually a mistake, I think. I think it should have been RemStaR and he's the one that's super tanky at the moment. He's the one that should be running in on the front lines and just right-clicking buildings, daring heroes to come at him.
I agree.
But I guess giving Hussein a second lease on life is also not too bad. Mm-hmm. I mean, after all, RemStaR does have the cheese, and it's going to be impossible to kill him in just a single spot.
Yep, RemStaR just needs to stay alive. He and the Ember, I mean, if they do manage to just survive through the Echo Slam as well as the Ice Blast, I think they have what it takes to eventually bring down the Alchemist as well as the Weaver. How close is he to the Octane? It's going to be a while. Has Enchantress completed the Ag Scepter? Not yet. Okay, Chains, the magic damage. Kiko really feeling the pain, but the Chemical Rage just heals through most of that damage.
I think the bigger issue here is that the RemStaR has recognized how difficult it is to push up against an Alchemist with Acid Strain Radiance.
Yep.
He's actually brought in two lanes pushing in towards the dire side of the map. So now it's going to be a really difficult choice. Do you defend the top side, do you defend the middle lane? Because if you commit to one, you know for a fact that the Crusaders are going to be coming charging in from the other. Mm-hmm. Watch for the Searing Chains initiation, because that will be the cue for RemStaR to come to the back line. With the Haunt being popped, they could disable the Earthshaker's Blink Dagger, and if they can kill the Earthshaker before he pops that Echo Slam, it could be all she wrote, and in fact, he could be singing on the side of the Dire.
Do you think RemStaR just takes the chance and goes YOLO and tries to jump onto the Earthshaker? Is that how Crusaders could look at starting this fight? They're just going to wait for Invincible to complete the Ag Scepter, push back Akramaks into their own base, try and squeeze them out of the map.
I mean, it is now or never. I mean, they're walking around with an Aegis and a Cheese. You don't want to waste that just yet. Dream. He's going to TP out for now in the face of Bakemono on that Aegis. Still opting to pick up creeps like the Dark Troll Summoner for the extra disable and the extra pushing potential that comes with the raised end. Having that Golem as well, again, multiple units on the battlefield, multiple stuns and lockdowns coming in. Although I think it might be time to switch things up and just pick up creeps that people or YouTube creeps that people more out this time around.
Aegis and Cheese with the Crusaders, the pressure to end definitely on them.
There is such a thing as waiting too long, as we've pointed out time and again.
There is, but they're not finding the opening. I mean, the best opening they can find is RemStaR just haunting and jumping on the Earthshaker. That's...
I don't know, man. I think at this point, you can simply send the Spectre on the front lines, have her right-click the buildings, and follow up if they jump her instead.
Okay. I mean, it's definitely worth trying.
Let's be honest, with 3,600 health on her and with dispersion, not to mention a good 21 armor, they're not going to kill her in one stun lock.
Absolutely, I think what you're going to do when you see a Spectre drop a bit of malice, maybe the Firestorm plus the Swarm, I guess that just tickles RemStaR at this point.
The only thing that they have working against him is that the cheese won't be effective with the Ice Blast connection. So that could be an opening to kill off the Spectre. But if you do commit everything on the Spectre, it's not like the Sand King, the Lich.
I'm just going to spectate, absolutely. They're going up, Invincible jumps in. He jumped right on top of Aggressive to Gucci along with the time lapse to keep him alive. And a quick Remnant to get away, but the Horn comes in from RemStaR. He's trying to get Makusu, force out the Ice Blast. The Ice Blast will clip the Spectre. They're all going to run away. The Green comes up from the Dire. The Unstable Concoction being channeled, thrown out as well. But here's Darshan, the Epicenter, all to do. Bakuman goes in with the Impet as he's trying to bring down Aggressive, who's popped his BKB and just spectating. Darshan, though, will favor his life. Aggressive on the killing spree. The Horn and everything being thrown out by Crusaders. All they did was lose the Sand King and force out a couple of BKBs.
They made it too long. They dodged the entire epicenter damage. They dodged the entire chain cross damage. And Hussein is all about the magic damage this game. They pretty much keep nailing everything he had to throw at them. This is going to send warning bells ringing across the Crusaders camp. And of course, it's going to be blaring the charge horn here for Akramaks as they should be ready to come back and fight.
I mean, they've got their BKBs, they've got the Echo Slam. It's tempting to try and just maybe take down the Tier 1 at mid. Mm-hmm. Worth considering. RemStaR, he hunted, he went on the Ancient Apparition, but he didn't fully commit. I sense a certain hesitation in RemStaR in that fight. Despite him having the insurance policy of the cheese, he really didn't want to overcommit in that fight. And maybe RemStaR needs to take a little more of a risk in this game with the Heart.
I think these figures have made a mistake here. They should not be looking to start the fight inside the Dire base. If you're looking for a kickoff, you do it outside the base. If you're looking to go up into the high ground, you start hitting the building, because that's what Dota's about. Breaking buildings is what wins you games.
Just have RemStaR hitting the building?
Have RemStaR hit the building. If they commit on RemStaR, that's when you counter commit upon the rest of their heroes. Also, if you can bait out BKBs, run away and come back for the next fight, that is absolutely perfect for Crusaders. These are the two objectives they should be looking at. Chip damage or BKB baits.
Yes, sorry, they did that. I mean, they baited out the Weaver's BKB, but then RemStaR just followed up with the Haunt and Darshan went with the Epicenter. I mean, there was a lack of communication. Darshan went in with the Epicenter. By the time RemStaR came out of the base and there was nothing to follow up with the Epicenter, it wasn't a bad Epicenter. It did manage to hit two of them. It's not a lot. What? RemStaR Haunt? Who's he gone upon? Where is the RemStaR?
Oh, they're bottom. He's bottom. He's gone onto the Uber Lord, and Uber Lord is out of there! I mean, this is that time when you put like an all-chat question mark if you're playing Southeast Asian pub.
Absolutely. Dream forcing out the Horn, forcing out a couple of rotations. SSK needs to be careful. The Glimmer Game is going to keep him alive.
Both sides just all bark and no bite, just baring their fangs at each other. But that was a Haunt baited out, put down on cooldown for a good 80 seconds. Spectre is not going to be happy with that one, and neither are the rest of Crusaders.
Absolutely. The Crusaders dugout has really quieted down. I mean, they were all Bol Bachchan, Amitabh Bachchan during the Counter-Strike match, but they're just watching patiently because 43 minutes in, there isn't a clear winner. Sure, the Crusaders have a 10k net worth advantage, but I mean, it's just a matter of one fight for this to swing back in anyone's favor right now.
Unlike a game of Counter-Strike, the score, the numbers don't mean anything in Dota. It's entirely about which team can bring down this final building, the quickest. We're at 44 minutes in,
heard of me?
And neither side has a clear shot at victory just yet.
Absolutely, Dota is not a game of numbers. It's like getting marks in art school. They don't mean anything. And right now, I really don't know who's going to take this.
What's the win condition here for Blue Frog and his boys?
I think Blue Frog and his boys can wait. I mean, they've got a couple of decent axe scepters to distribute. the Ancient Apparition is this poor. The Axe Scepter and the Ancient Apparition is going to be nice.
What Axe Scepter? Come on, he's walking around with Ground Boots.
I mean, if the Alchemist gives him one, that's what I meant.
That's a fair point.
Yeah, so, I mean, they can still wait. They have
nothing. It's what he's going for.
I wouldn't be too opposed to giving it to the Weaver either. The Weaver Axe could be nice.
I definitely think the Ancient Apparition is the prime candidate for it.
Okay.
Honestly, personal opinion, I think Ancient Apparition's Axe upgrade is one of the most powerful in the game. And you'd be a fool not to give it over to
it. It is. But think about it this way, they're struggling to kill one hero, and imagine if you end up time-lapsing him as well. I mean, how do they go high ground? You can just wait out this game even longer.
I'm also thinking that it's time for Akramaks to try and play offensively. They're just sitting in their base time and again. They're not leaving their high ground.
Yeah.
They're just too scared.
They are playing really defensive Dota right now. We do understand that if you're the Alchemist, you want to draw this game as long as possible. But how long is too much is the question.
Well, he did finish up the Axe, and
who's he giving it to?
Clearly, he's given it over to
given it to the Ancient
Apparition. It's time to fight, guys. You no longer wait for them to take the next Aegis and come back at you, because then you're going to end up in this vicious cycle where you'll take bit by bit, you'll take chip damage on your tier 3s, on your barracks, you lose buildings and you won't know what hit you. Now, this is an Axe Ice Blast going into the pit. It connects on just one, which is Invincible, who has a ready to come back to rest in just a bit, while the rest of his team takes down Roshan. This is a mistake. Kiko and his boys should be contesting Roshan.
Yeah. Blue Frog has a Bling Dagger on the Earthshaker. It's go time. Pop a smoke, move into the Rosh Pit. Darshan, all by himself in the mid lane, needs to be careful. He's got the Blink and the 4-star, so he's going to be okay. They're once again going to give away Aegis without contest to Crusaders. Here comes Blue Frog, he's Darshan. A Ucypher comes out. Kiko channeling up the unstable concoction. He's going to connect upon Darshan. The Lotus Orb is going to buy some time. Swamp comes flying through. The Barrow Strike is going to keep him away. Here comes Ice Blast number 2. It's on to a bunch of them. But the Aegis is on the floor. It's still on the floor. RemStaR picks it up. The Bitter Malice catches a bunch of them. Blue Frog with the Fisherman gets the kill on Bakimono while aggressive brings down the Lich. Kiko going ham in the pit. RemStaR forced to dagger run away. There's the Epi Center, but it only tinkles with the 5 coming up from the Earthlord. They're focusing now on the Sand King. They'll get that kill as well. Invincible pushed the Remnant away. He's low on HP, low on luck, and low on teammates to keep him alive. Blue Frog manages to end up going down. A killing spree taken away, but RemStaR will fall. The Aegis run away with the Bitter Malice still available, and it's waiting for RemStaR.
This is a rampage.
But look at the Remnant. He gets the kill on the A. Invincible makes that double. Aggressive will fall. It's Kiko in the pit. It's RemStaR and Invincible. They've done it. It's a D-Drive coming up from Crusaders. And RemStaR can finally go high ground.
This respect being shown by Akramaks over there, not respecting the fact that RemStaR's a hard nut to crack, let alone the fact that Invincible has himself an upstream core, plus the bonus duration and the searing chains. He's going to be constantly locking you down, and you cannot fight versus them if you don't have anything to do. Now they're going to have to force out buyback. Two more heroes have buyback on the side of Akramaks, but that tier 3 is injected, and it takes a significant amount of damage. Buyback never comes down. But remember, there's still a huge available on RemStaR, and it even makes it progress towards the butterfly. The same, he said on the front line, he slowed down the same game and backed away. They forced out 3 buybacks on the side of the guy and escaped scot-free. Akramaks taking a massive economic blow over there, while RemStaR and his boys managed to come out the victors of that skirmish.
Absi Bhushnada, what are your thoughts on RemStaR's itemization? Butterfly, you think it's the right call?
I'm still a fan of
the Abyssal Blade. Yeah,
I think they need that lockdown, man.
I agree. The Abyssal is really going to help them. It's going to let RemStaR get a bunch of hits on an isolated Edo. And with Desolation, it's going to do a lot of work.
Absolutely. I think that isolation, if you can isolate an Earthshaker and bring it down, or if you can isolate even an Alchemist and bring it down, that could work well for them.
This is going to be nice. It's going to be reliable lockdown versus the Weaver. You can ensure that he doesn't get out of the CJ and maybe try and burst him down. Those 3 Remnants though in the previous fight were Invincible.
Welcome back, coupled with the fact that Spectre is just working all the
right now, the Dota 2 game looks like this could be in anyone's favor. Am I right?
Yes, setup.
Crusaders, they're going for the killing blow. Pickoff now could be huge, aggressive. He's all by himself in the jungle. They need to lock him down before he gets off his BKB. Dash him with the power strike. Invincible with the chains. They're controlling the Weaver. The BKB pop, the time lapse, the minute aggressive, make a run for it. Like the pop that he is, goes back to his base.
BKB time lapse, spending on aggressive. He's now got himself that BKB down to 6 seconds. All is online. Everything is online on the side of the Crusaders. Be ready to go.
No, but what
are Crusaders going to hit buildings or look for a fight? What? I mean,
right,
we said they should be hitting buildings.
No, we can't.
Yeah, I still think it's
we're not losing. I'm in denial.
Okay, but 4.1k HP, a butterfly, and 27 armor. How do you even kill him once, let alone twice with that chief?
And they started off with
butterfly, ages. Excuse me, cheese, a heart. Look at this, a row of ice vortexes await the creeps. Aggressive time, clear the creeper. Invincible with the Lotus Orb, he's jumped in. He's gone into the Alchemist. Excuse me, the Earth Shaker.
This is bad. They're gonna go in further.
They're posting out a bunch of key spells.
So there are lots of learnings that are already
happening. RemStaR and Co should be taking this fight. One more single chain to commit. Good fish.
He's just baiting out as many spells as possible. While mid lane, it's the Enchantress with the Dragon Lance, if I'm not mistaken. He's become a sniper of sorts. The Pit of Malice along with the 4 stars and Lich push pull and lock down. Not enough.
Continues to do his thing on the top lane. Meanwhile, he's going to throw down the dagger on aggressive, tagging him while he runs about. While mid lane, they're trying to push in as well. Two sides, split push Dora, Rat Dora at his finest. Continues made him about to fall, while Spectre is ready to go in on the top side as well. All the while though, Hussein has chosen to move himself back towards the bottom lane to defend a tier 2 tower.
Does he have a remnant?
Mamusu? He actually killed off Bakemon.
What? Okay. So, Crusaders have two completely opposing ideas how to end this game. Bakemono is trying to just siege. And he's just trying to hit towers, but the rest of Crusaders, I mean, Invincible backed off. Bakemono wants to siege. Maybe that's one way of doing it. Let Bakemono go up. If they initiate on the Enchantress, you guys just wait for a lot of heroes to show and commit, and then you guys counter-initiate yourselves. You got the cheese on RemStaR. RemStaR's, I mean, still playing it a little safe as far as hitting buildings is concerned. At some point, Crusaders have to take the risk and just go smack buildings down. The mid tower, if you look at the dire mid tower, it's pretty low. Bakemono's done a fair amount of damage.
I mean, really, the game plan should not be Spectre split pushing this game. It's got to be Spectre going with the Enchantress. If you don't want to send your own body up on the high ground, just take out two illusions while the Enchantress hits from the low ground, send the illusions up top, take down this tier 3, and then open up the fight when there's no tower to defend. I don't see why Crusaders are waiting so long. It, you know, without sugarcoating it, it's poor decision-making coming out from Crusaders again. They're panicking when they're on the cusp of victory here. And that's exactly what Akramaks are making the most out of.
Yeah. Haste. I mean, India's ki best team bhi. When jab high ground ka sawal aata hai, their decision-making has a lot to be desired. And Crusaders, they're a little unsure as to how to end this game. Bakemono going for Scyther Wise herself. You've got one picked up on the Underlord. I'm not sure if Crusaders have spotted this out, but Underlord has a sheep stick.
I think the classic mistake here is that...
Invincible goes in, he's got the Underlord, Shiva's Guard, Chains, everything committed. A Pit of Malice and a Swarm drawn out from the Dire. Bakemono, it's a little...
He's got his spells back online, he wants to go in, but the Fissure Block will keep them out. For now, he's going to go in, he jumps in, takes the tier 3, tries to get out, but gets hexed up immediately. The Force, the Mimic Cave, and then the Jump over to the Remnant will keep him alive. The damage has been done. The tier 3 is taken out, and that means that the Shrines will now fall, and Crusaders will find themselves a minor victory once again. Maybe not though, they're going in for Kiko. The Barasek is there behind, but the BKB's been popped. Aggressive, he's lowered in speed, but he manages to time lapse all of the damage away. While Spectre's popped the Hawk and gone in behind with the Shrine's activated in the Echo Slam just on the Spec. But look at the dispersion damage coming out. The Blue Frog taking a beating in the front line. The Hex is there, the G is not available anymore. Spectre's still alive, and Kiko will drop as he misses the deck for 111 seconds. While Uberlord is back in the fountain. Is this all she wrote for Akramaks as Crusaders have come knocking on the door? Kus kus ke maar rahe Crusaders, Akramaks, on their last move.
Yeah, moments of panic here coming up from Akramaks. That one man Echo Slam and no impact. And look at that, another Sheep's Take, a Bubble Strike, a bunch of four stars. They're playing football with this cockroach, and Aggressive has to run back to his own fountain. The Ice Blast though, this could be a kill. The Glimmer Cape, I'm not sure if it's going to keep Darshan alive. Dream's trying to hold on. There's many barracks under siege. RemStaR, eyes on the prize. He's trying to bring down the barracks. There's not much an Unlock can do all by himself. Bakimono caught in the gold feet. Can they bring him down? Enchantress, Pit of Malice, everything to bring down Enchantress. But look at that. They're forced up the low from the Radiant. And Invincible has gone in. He's being controlled with the Sheepstick itself. He needs to be a little bit careful. Not sure if he has a Remnant to go out. RemStaR, though, he just moved on to Broom Frog. That's a dieback on the Earthshaker, if I'm not mistaken. Makusu make a run for it. Nowhere he can go. The chains are there. They control the Uber. And the Uber cannot move. Invincible brings him down. Only the Ancient Apparition and the Weaver stand. And with RemStaR alive, this should very easily be another lane of barracks. He's got the cheese, The Heart Regen isn't kicking in. The Ice Blast will be sidestep. It's only Bakimono who ends up eating it. Invincible trying to distract him as much as possible. The time lapse forced out from the Weaver. A sentry drop deep from SSK. RemStaR.
He's back up to full HP with the Heart Regen kicking in now. He's back to fight again. It's going to be two lanes of barracks. No buybacks on the forward on the side of the Dire. Akramaks, they're losing buildings time and again. They're falling like flies, and now the Weaver's been controlled up by the Roots and brought down as well. It's a dieback on the Weaver. 90 seconds without him. Akramaks, they've been beaten emphatically here by Crusaders with a 40,000 net worth lead and a 20,000 EXP lead. The Tier 4s, they've come a knocking, and RemStaR's the one that's going to bring it down. Ice Blast is good measure, but not nearly enough.
I'm sorry, I got distracted for a moment. I'm looking at SSK smiling, wondering what my teammates are screaming. Invincible, he's literally invincible. He's going in, killing them all alone. Kills a Weaver solo. I haven't seen an Ember who's magic heavy do that. And Blue Frog, he goes into the Fissure with the Enchant Totem. At this point, it's nothing. The Crusaders have done it. If I'm not, they did end up losing the game of CS. But they've come back in Dota.